In this graph, we want to look at another oxygen-binding protein known as myoglobin. And myoglobin is found in the cytoplasm of striated muscle, especially cardiac muscle and slow-twitch skeletal muscle. It actually gives the reddish color to that particular tissue. Now, let's first look at hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is our blood-carried oxygen-binding protein, and it has four subunits. Those subunits demonstrate cooperativity, an interaction between those subunits that generates the sigmoid shape of our red hemoglobin curve here. That's very adaptive, as hemoglobin will fully saturate at PO2s of about 100 that we see at the lungs in the alveolar air, and then will tend to desaturate to a degree at our tissues where the PO2 is in the 20 to 40 range. The sigmoid shape is very adaptive. It makes the curve very steep in the range of the tissue PO2s, such that when we go from 40 at rest down to about 20 in active tissues, we get a dramatic increase in the unloading of oxygen to those tissues. Now, if we look at the myoglobin curve, what we see, first of all, is that it is dramatically left-shifted of the hemoglobin curve. This indicates that it has a much higher affinity for oxygen. This is shown by the P50 values. The P50 for myoglobin is about 3 millimeters of mercury PO2. The P50 for hemoglobin is way over here at about 27 millimeters of mercury PO2. Remember, P50 is simply the partial pressure of oxygen required to generate 50% saturation. The fact that myoglobin is 50% saturated at a PO2 of 3 indicates that it has very high affinity for binding oxygen. Now, you might look at the curve for myoglobin and say, well, in the tissues, the myoglobin is simply going to remain attached to the oxygen. It's really not going to deliver it or hand it off within the cell. This actually isn't true. These tissue PO2s are measured in the interstitium. As we enter the cell, cross the membrane and enter the cell, the PO2 will start to fall fairly dramatically. That's true because the mitochondria are utilizing that oxygen. And the closer we get to the mitochondria, the lower the PO2 becomes. In fact, mitochondrial PO2 is about 3 millimeters of mercury. So what happens is the myoglobin will bind oxygen at the cell surface, right, in the cytoplasm, in this PO2 range of 20 to 40, nearly saturate. It will then diffuse through the cytoplasm and tend to unload fairly dramatically as it approaches the mitochondrion, where the PO2 falls to about 3. This is adaptive. Myoglobin is acting as an intracellular shuttle for oxygen. It's also helping to keep the oxygen inside the cell bound. This maintains the gradient for diffusion from the interstitium into the cell. The last thing we want to point out about myoglobin is that its curve is not sigmoidal. It's actually what we call hyperbolic. And it's hyperbolic because it has a single subunit for binding oxygen and therefore cannot demonstrate subunit cooperativity.